Welcome everyone to this week's review of my trades for our briefing trader service. I am your host, Scott Smith, also known as BlueChipTrader, under the ticker BLUEX. And I know it's been about 2 weeks or so since my last update. I've kind of been off on the weekends and stuff, the Fridays, for personal reasons. But I'm just going to try to keep everyone, bring everyone up to speed here as quickly, hopefully as less painful as possible. So if we take a look at the markets real quick, and we go into the end of September, into early October. So sentiment was running pretty high here at the latter half of September, with the third quarter of the year wrapping up. Markets were correcting back in August. They tried to recover and bounce, during mid-September. And then you could see this trend line was broken off the August low, early September price action. And this really kind of had triggered some more selling into the end of the quarter. A lot of portfolios were looking to take the losers and the losses, off their books and, try to just, steer out of the way of risk. When the VIX itself, which is a nice risk indicator, starts to trade above the $20 level, you can see more volatility in the market. And that's going to usually typically be associated with bear markets. There's a lot looser action going on. Spreads become wider, daily ranges become wider. You're going to see more gap ups and gap downs on a daily basis. And so to avoid that type of headache that's associated with higher volatility, people tend to cut back a little bit on overall trading. And, just risk management becomes crucial at these times. And one of the key elements is usually cutting back on the number of trades and the size of trading. And so liquidity kind of dries up. Now, that's great if you're a scalper and an intraday trader, because the opportunities to make fast money are going to be plentiful. But from a swing trading basis, which is really kind of my bread and butter, you really have to kind of adjust there, because it could be a real kind of headache if you overbet or you overtrade and you're not scaling out profits properly. And if you don't take your losses just as quickly, that can really kind of snowball into something really nasty. So with that said, we could see that the market was kind of really under pressure here in late September. And right around here, I kind of had this in my philosophy I was posting to the site, that these losses were being cleared off the books. And I felt like with Q3 ending, we were going to see some money flowing back into these markets here in early October. And fortunately, this premise did play out. There were a lot of stocks that sold off 10, 15, 20% into late September. And it just seemed like they were just overdue for some sort of bounce to come back into the market here. So in late September, a few names, I'll just go through them quick without going into too much detail, but we did pick up Caterpillar. I don't remember why it gapped down. I want to say they guided lower here. It was not earnings. But they had gapped down significantly from the $670 level to a fresh multi-month low. We had these 2 days here, and we got in right on this day here, September, I want to say 29th, right around $64 as it started to actually show signs of coming back through for a bounce. Got in around 64, risking $2 for a swing, which still gave us plenty of room down here to hold on to it while chopped around here. And you can see back in early October, buyers started coming back into the name. We had a nice $6 gain back up to the $70 level. And you can see they kind of just kind of kept pushing it higher here with the rest of the market this week. We still have this big downtrend over the last few months to deal with, as well as price action is below the 50-day moving average. So this is a counter trend trade. It could possibly roll over here, but right now we've taken our chunk of our profits off for a nice $6-7 gain here, and so it's really kind of just what happens from here is really it's not that big of a deal right now for me, because we have our balance stops around 65-66 area. Another trade that we were looking at that time into late September was this Schlumberger. you know, again, a big, really late sell-off, and it was energy stocks started to consolidate. If you read my swing trader column on our briefing plus service, you could tell, you knew that I was pretty bullish about energy stocks the last few weeks. Just the way they've been coming off their lows in August and September, and the consolidations they've been forming. You know, I felt like there was going to be this rotation out of overbought biotech sector and go into this oversold energy sector headed into Q4. So fortunately, again, this did play out. You know, Schlumberger was also one of the few stocks that I saw that actually bought out another company over the last few weeks. So to me, that this was one of these stocks that management is either really, really smart or really, really stupid for doing something like that. So they took full, I kind of saw it as the smarter side of it. They took advantage of buying another company. CAM was a company they bought out. And, you know, when it came down below the 70 level, it was a buying opportunity back in August, which we took advantage of. And when it started to dip below here, you know, I was looking for the same sort of opportunity. It took out the low here. And you can see this kind of almost an outside day here on October 2nd. And it was a really strong close here that, you know, in the energy sector was kind of rallying that day, October 2nd. So we took a swing long into the close around $70 there. Fortunately, we did gap up the next day for a quick little partial profit to trim some profits on. And as a swing on the whole, we caught about a nice $7 gain back up to the September highs here. And we're still holding. Again, similar to Caterpillar, you have this bigger multi-month downtrend in effect. The 50-day moving averages are also in effect here. But overall, we do have a nice gain sitting on the remaining balance. So it's just worth a hold for now. Let's see. Alibaba. This was one of the most disappointing IPOs I've seen in a long time, especially for one that was just so hyped. And, you know, the structure here is kind of similar. Really kind of sold off throughout the summer months and had that big gap down in August when the rest of the market came back, retested at least late September. And so it was on my radar as, you know, similar to the Caterpillar and the Schlumberger, all these stocks around these August lows, it's waiting for some sort of reversal signal. And that came on October 2nd. And really strong buyers came in here and I started going trend up on October 2nd. It was a little late on the entry. I would have liked to have gotten in closer to the prior highs. On the breakout around 60, 61. So at 62, we only took half size because we were a little bit late on that entry. I was looking to add, though, if it did come back in the next day, I was looking to add back maybe a quarter size around $60, $61 if it did pull back a little bit. That didn't happen. And it did just kind of, you know, pushed higher here the next 5 days for a, you know, decent gain of about 6.7 points back up to the 50-day moving average. Again, took profits on it and just kind of sitting here with this remaining long balance around break-even area just to see what kind of develops going forward from here. Another one that I did want to start focusing on some leading stocks in the market as opposed to buying some of the ones that got hit really hard. So as I was scrolling through the charts in late September, Reynolds, RJ Reynolds, RAI, actually showed up as a stock that was showing a lot of relative strength. And you can see it was just holding the 50-day moving average in this nice tight consolidation here throughout late August, most of September, and into the end of September when most stocks were selling off, this stock actually started to break out. So we bought some as it traded right through the 42 area, and we caught a nice little gain of about $2 into the month end. Had a nice little pop here over 45 to start the month. So that was a gain of about 3 to trim some profits on. Pulled back, still held a break-even support level above the you know, the breakout point, as well as the 20-period moving average. And kind of just trailed our balance here and it hit 46.75 last Friday, which was good for a 5-point gain. So, again, this is just kind of focusing on a leading stock. You know, this is also on one of our briefing plus services, RJ Reynolds, which also brought to my attention based upon its relative strength. Another name that was showing relative strength throughout September was actually Netflix. And this stock has really been my go-to trading stock the last couple weeks. Just the volatility has been great since it split. I can't remember exactly what the split was, how many shares were exchanged back in the summer. But, you know, this price level around $90, $100 has just been a really excellent trader. And every time it gets below 100, I noticed that there were buyers stepping in and defending it. And they were selling at around 105 area, coming down below 100. They were buying it back and flipping it back and forth. So really just kind of made some great trading opportunities here in September. Heading into the end of September into October, you had this 3 days down here, this little pullback pattern here. So once it started clearing the prior day's high, we got in long around 102. Next day, you know, trimmed some here at 105 and held onto a balance around 102. And I kind of started trading around that, the swing balance position that I was holding. And I really kind of took a lot of good trades here. And I'll just kind of go over them real quickly. Most of it was based upon a 60-minute chart, which, you know, again, based upon the high volatility, sometimes you have to go down to a smaller time frame even for a swing trader. You know, swing traders usually focus on the weekly and the dailies. But because the volatility has gotten so high the last couple of weeks, it's you can actually drop down to like a 60, 30-minute chart and really kind of you know, just see the opportunities develop the same way you're doing it daily. Just some really nice opportunities developing here. So starting with, you know, we had gone along into late September, right around the 102 area. You can see right here. This was basically the pattern, that three-day down breakout. And we got long around 102, trimmed some profits. Fast forward to October 1st. I added to this position. We had gapped down initially, or not gapped down, but we opened lower, let's say, and we started to turn here during the first 2 hours, 3 hours here, and go positive again. And I decided to add to the position right around 105.75. We held it overnight into the fifth, and you can see we had a really nice 4 or 5 point gain as price shot up early on October 5th to the 110 level to trim some profits on. We also, I believe I added, this was another position here too, on October 5th that I added to on the first hour range breakout. I believe it was more of a 107 area, according to my notes that we added. It was probably some sort of opening range breakout. I think I can zoom in on that. I don't want to spend too much time on this, cause I did take quite a few, trades. So yeah, so you can see here that the initial on October 2nd, I'm sorry, on October 1st, it looks like we actually, we scaled out of profits here for a 4 point gain. That was from the 102 entry. And on October 5th, this is when you had the, you know, the prior day had gapped down and closed strong. And then October 5th, you had this consolidation pattern here during the first half hour or so. And we got long in this opening range breakout. We added back to our swing low position here around 107.50. And that was good for about a 3 point gain, you know, throughout the morning. And then it, throughout by the afternoon, it was good for just about a 5 point gain, which really paid off nicely. Fast forward to October 6th. And it looks like I added another position right here on, as the price came down into the midday. We added back to this position around the 106, 107 area. So you see price was selling off down here. This trend line was broken here, and I felt like the market was going to be stabilizing, bouncing. We added back to it, and we caught a nice $2 gain. Into the morning, the next morning, if you held overnight, it was 109.5 for a nice $2.5 gain as well. If we fast forward to October 8th, again, this was a position that I was just kind of carrying a small balance on for the swing of the last few days. And I did wind up actually getting out on this day. October 8th was a pretty tricky day. So I was bullish on the stock, you know, trying to look for opportunities to set up on the long side. And I believe I did add, I'm looking at my notes right here. I did add initially as it cleared the prior day's high small position back here. I'm hoping it would kind of extend a little higher here over the 110 area. And price did reverse, and it looks like a $2 loss as it came back down below the initial opening range and went negative on the day there. It came down a little bit lower, broke below 105 here. And when it broke below 105, it took us out of our entire swing long position that we had from the end of September at 102 for about a $3 gain. To me, that was kind of like the lowest it's been trading in the last few days. And I just kind of wanted out of it. Selling kind of accelerated there. And then kind of out of nowhere, I believe the company announced that they were raising their subscriptions by a dollar on their main staple service level. And that just kind of launched price really much, much higher throughout the day there. We were not part of the trade there because I did get stopped out at 105 for that remaining balance there. So I kept it on my radar because I'm not one to chase headlines. But after about an hour, you can see here the stock started stabilizing right around this key level that I was looking at earlier, you know, that I had gone in earlier around the 110 area, 109 area. And so I went back in, suggested we went back in here around 109, 110 area. And sure enough, in the afternoon, buyers stepped back in and we had a nice gain of about $4 going into the close there. Trim some profits there, and just kind of sitting with the rest of this position here. It looks really good. Still, I think the price action is constructive. You know, right now going forward into this coming week, I'm kind of looking at this 112, 115 area as the you know, consolidation, and hopefully we break out over to the 116 area, get a nice push, possibly back up to 120s. If, you know, up here, if it starts to drop back below 109. Different scenario. I'll probably just take the, you know, scratch out the remaining balance there. A few other stocks I just want to quickly mention before this gets too long. I did take a small loss on Apple on October 2nd, or October 1st, I believe it was. You know, the market, Apple was kind of showing relative weakness here until September, and you can see it was kind of breaking down again, and I thought it was going to go lower. It was taking out this early September low, which was really a concern for me. I was thinking it was going to just kind of roll over here and start dropping back into this 105 area. Buyer stepped up and they reversed it. And so we just kind of took a quick hit on that one. But at the same time, that was kind of a good thing because it should have rolled over. Again, the great thing about technical analysis is you can look at a pattern and say to yourself, all right, this is what the stock should do. And when it doesn't happen, it's a warning signal that you basically are wrong in your thesis or your premise. And you should reduce your risk and get out of that position. Same thing happened with Facebook. Price came down real hard into late September, kind of bounced here for 2 days, and it's formed like this, what looked like a bear flag pattern developing. Opened lower, started to come down right to this low here, and I was playing the break. Hopefully it would break down these two lows and come down to, you know, slip $3-$4, continue lower. For a nice swing trade or a day trade, and buyers stepped right in and they started reversing it right back up to the 90 level, back up through the prior day's high, just showing that the stock was not as weak as I thought it was. So we just had to kind of scoop it, take the loss in that one as well. Amba was another stock that's kind of been absolutely crushed throughout the third quarter. So I was looking for it to bounce on my radar. I don't remember exactly what day it was. I have to look at my notes, but I believe it popped here. I was looking for the break over $60. It popped real quick for about $1.50 gain, and then it just kind of reversed on us. And so we wound up, I think, taking a scratch on that trade as it came back through $58. You know, we kind of just ate away at the prior partial profit that we had taken. So that was a small little scratch. Yum Brands, I believe it was earnings that they had this big gap down on. And, you know, the actual day that it sold off on earnings was October 7th, I believe. Yeah. And really big hit. And I was just kind of looking to play some sort of bounce in the name after all the initial emotional selling had taken hold. And this is kind of the pattern I was looking at. Price broke down, tried to hold the 68 level here for about 10 minutes. And then you can see sellers start to resume below the $68 level. And kind of told myself if it reversed, as it, you know, buyers, what I like to see is that buyers try to hold a particular level and they fail it. And when they fail to hold a certain level, sometimes that's just kind of a shakeout move. And I'm looking for the second attempt at that. And so basically when price broke down below the 68 support, I wanted to get long if they came running back in, you know, almost sucking. They kind of sucked in shorts on this move here. Once the support level was broken, I wanted to come back in for a squeeze back over 68. It did trigger the next bar, as you can see here. And, you know, again, this is a short-term day trade. I'm usually looking for only about 50 cents to a dollar on these type of trades. This is not a swing trade. Price stabilized there around 68 for a few bars. Was kind of risking the current low, which was about 75 cents to a dollar. And fortunately, after kind of risking, came back down here, never really made a new low there. And eventually, I believe it did shoot up to the $69 area, which I want to say was right around here. You know, we just kind of held on to it for about 2 hours there in the morning. It was kind of nerve-wracking a little bit, you know, because day trades, you know, you take on a little bit longer side for a quicker gain. But the fact that it never really broke down a full dollar, it's trying to risk a dollar to make a dollar. So we did kind of make that dollar point and then eventually just took scratched it out into the rest of the day as the day went on. Let's see. Another trade that I was looking at last week and took on for a nice swing is this MBLY. And again, it kind of really more just like the price action here. You can see how it came down hard in August. And there was a buyer at 42, September, a buyer at 42, late September, a buyer at 42. So you can kind of see this whole pattern developing. This downtrend started to break here. And it seems like this $50 area is some significant resistance area. It's trying to form this kind of this bullish flag pullback pattern here off this run up here. So we took a swing long in here around the $49 area. And I'm kind of hoping that there's going to be some sort of push above this $50 resistance area, generate some sort of squeeze. Initial targets around $52, which is the 50-day moving average. So we'll see how that plays out. Let's see. The next one that I did take also as a swing last week would be Tesla. And, you know, relative weakness is pretty heavy here the last 2 weeks, but the market's stabilizing, holding up. And I feel like the selling is kind of oversold here. You know, prices come down here. You could make the argument that there's some sort of, there's a down channel here. Maybe some people want to call it a falling wedge pattern, you know, but just multiple down days down. I just kind of started looking at this 220 area, which was this closing price, 219, 220. It just kind of looked like a support level where buyers would kind of step in here. So I wanted to start scaling in around 220, which we started doing on Friday. We'll see what happens. You know, if you get five points out of it, that's great to scale out of. If you get 10 points, that's even better. You know, kind of keeping my expectations fairly low here, but kind of just looking at this whole kind of high 210, 219, 218 area support for some sort of turn. Again, it's a high price stock. You can look at a 60-minute chart and kind of see that down channel kind of in the lower half of it, support area. And, you know, like I said, if you kind of get 5 to 10 points out of it, I'll take it. And I believe that pretty much wraps up the amount of trades I took for the last 2 weeks or so. You know, there were a few. Excuse me, that's my alarm going off. There were a few trades that I just real quick at hedges. You know, I don't like to take if I don't take a partial profit in a swing long position. You know that with I tend to take a hedge in an ETF like an SPY or an energy ETF or a financial ETF. Once I take a partial profit, to me, there's no reason to hedge it because, now I'm just trailing a stop in it. I'm trailing on the remaining balance. So worst case scenario, hopefully it's just kind of a wash where if I have not taken a position if I have not taken a partial profit in a swing, I tend to usually start to look at, you know, hedging that position, you know, not a full, one-to-one, ratio. Usually it's only about a third or, half at most, depending on how the market conditions are, if I'm bullish or bearish. But I did take a few hedges, on these, Netflix swings and these, Caterpillars and Schlumbergers, et cetera. Particularly the MBLY and the TSLA, just to kind of offset anything in case, you wake up after one weekend, you wake up and we have a significant gap down against us. It doesn't reduce your risk 100%, but it definitely mitigates it and lessens the damage that's being done. So it's just something to consider. So there were one or two hedges that I did take in the SPY on a few of these positions. I did take small losses on them of about $1 or $2, as the market was rallying last week. But again, they were not significant enough to take away from the profits that were going on. So that's it. So if you have any questions, always take a free trial of our Briefing Trader service. You can contact us through customer service. Check out our website, briefing.com. And hopefully I'll see you guys next week. Thanks.